louder than that.
Tonight we're going to have a fantastic lecture from Professor Art Greenburg, who I think probably everybody in this room knows very well, and I look forward very much to hearing his stories about the 1960s, told in the way that Art Greenburg would tell these kinds of stories. I think that's probably all I need to say on that. But before we talk a little bit more about what Professor Greenburg has done in his career, first I want to recognize Mrs. Charlotte Noe, who's with us again tonight. And Mrs. Noe is the widow of Dr. Clarence Noe, for whom this series was named, and she has been constant supporter of this college and certainly of this series, and so it's wonderful to see you again. Professor Art Greenburg joined Eureka College in 2000 after a long and distinguished career as a lawyer and judge in Peoria. Since that time, Professor Greenburg has established himself as a highly respected teacher and mentor for students pursuing careers in criminal justice. His talents as a teacher were recognized in 2005 when Professor Greenburg was selected as the winner of the Helen Cleaver Distinguished Teaching Award, the highest teaching award at Eureka College. Outside the classroom, Professor Greenburg has become an active member of the college community, who can be seen at college events and most days holding court in the commons with colleagues and students. Prior to joining the Eureka College faculty, Professor Greenburg was a lawyer in Peoria for 40 years and served as resident circuit judge in the 10th Judicial Circuit in Illinois. Earlier in his career, he served as assistant state's attorney in Peoria County and was licensed to practice in all federal courts and before the Supreme Court. He's held numerous positions in professional organizations, including president of the Peoria County Bar Association. In addition to teaching at Eureka College, he has lectured at University of Illinois Medical Center, Bradley University, and for the Illinois Bar Association. He has a long history of serving on boards of numerous organizations in his community and nationally. And tonight, he will discuss his work in civil rights movements in the mid-1960s. A polymath who was a wonderful colleague and a genuinely funny man, Art Greenburg has made a deep impression on his students and colleagues at Eureka College. Please join me in welcoming tonight's speaker, Professor Art Greenburg.
By the way, I could feel myself starting to blush a little bit. And, well, it's true. And I also wanted to thank Ms. Noe for the opportunity and the honor to talk to you tonight. And Professor, and let's see, our provost over here, Dr. Cavalier, was kind enough to give me that introduction, as well as our President Arnold. And I want to welcome everybody here. But before we start, I ask our people up in the booth there to play a record for us. I thought that maybe it would entertain you to hear about 3.5 minutes or 4 minutes of a record that may set the tone for my discussion and my lecture tonight. And why don't you fellas turn that on now, would you?
Western world, it is exploding. Violence flaring, boys loading. You're old enough to kill, but not for voting. You don't believe in war, but what's that gun you're toting? And even the Jordan River has bodies floating. But you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, I don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Don't you understand what I'm trying to say? Can't you feel the fears I'm feeling today? If the button is pushed, there's no running away. There'll be no one to save. We'll the world in the grave. Take a look around you, boy. It's bound to scare you, boy. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, I don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Yeah, my blood's so mad, feels like coagulating. I'm sitting here just contemplating. I can't twist the truth, it knows no regulation. Handful of senators don't pass legislation, and marches alone can't bring integration. When human respect is disintegrating, this whole crazy world is just too frustrating. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, I don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Think of all the hate there is in Red China, then take a look around to Selma, Alabama. You may leave here for 4 days in space, but when you return, it's the same old place. The pounding of the drums, the pride and disgrace. You can bury your dead, but don't leave a trace. Hate your next door neighbor, but don't forget to say grace and tell me.
Hope that set the mood for the evening. There are obviously all kinds of songs that cover the 60s and the period of the 60s. And as you probably all know, the 60s just didn't happen. There were all kinds of things that fed into Freedom Summer of 1964. Indeed, all kinds of things. When I was asked to do this lecture, of course, that's a very distinct honor. And I was concerned about what kind of thing that, or things that I could talk about that may be of interest to you that perhaps might be a little different than the kinds of things you're used to hearing. And I thought that this might be an interesting issue because there's so much happening today that is very disturbing, whether you want to look at our Tea Party or look at the Middle East or look at Africa and all kinds of things that are happening, the inhumanities. And I thought that this would be a very good subject. So I picked the subject and I started digging around for some of my own notes dealing with these issues. And the deeper I got into it, the more uncomfortable I became. And I want you to know that this evening, whereas I started looking at this thing in a very objective way, when I say this thing, I'm talking about the 60s, in a very objective way, I found myself getting emotionally involved in it. I was remembering things that I had placed aside, haven't thought of in years. And I found myself getting a little tearsome whether or not this was a good idea to visit some of these experiences that I'm going to talk about this evening, and how people treat one another, and what we haven't learned, and maybe have learned a little bit, what we have particularly not accomplished. And toward the end of what I'm going to say tonight, I'm going to tell you how I feel about what we were successful in doing and what we weren't successful in doing, even though we may have tried to do it. But in setting the platform for this kind of a discussion, I thought I might remind some of us, which in the past, the things that were passed out, were going on in the 60s, and were going on in Freedom Summer, the things that led up to it, because we were having student riots in the 60s all over the United States. On the West Coast, up in Chicago, we were having some things down in Southern Illinois that somebody was telling me about the other day that I didn't know what was going on in the southern part of Illinois. We had the 1964 Civil Rights Act that was passed, the 1965, the Voting Rights Act that was passed, and then you had all kinds of other things that were taking place throughout the country, all kinds of other so-called reforms. You had the Age of Aquarius, but Timothy Leary was going on at that time, and that was the man, as you may or may not recall, was the man that was imbibing LSD and letting it all hang out, and everything was okay. Everything was all right in the Age of Aquarius, and maybe it was okay in the Age of Aquarius. And I've listed some of the other things. Barry McGuire was just singing the Age of Destruction, and of course, that was a song that came out of the Vietnam War was going on during that period of time. And all the people, many students from all over the place, what they were doing at the time, they were protesting, and they had reached the streets, and there was all kinds of other things that were taking place. Like, for example, you may have forgotten that at one time, we had thousands of students, young people, who were burning graph cards in the street. That I will, hell no, I won't go. And I've seen parades like that. And in fact, I've seen parades like that in other parts of the world. Hell no, we won't go. And I was standing in London once when a whole group of people were walking by me, and hell no, we're not going to involve ourselves in another war in Vietnam. You had the Black Power Movement that was going on at the time. And the Black Power Movement was a period of time after peaceful non-resistance movement was going on with CORE and the Deep South. We had this, all these civil rights people, the kids from up north, were going down south and putting their lives on the line in the south. And of course, at that time, a father, Robert Grandin of the University of Boston up there, started to feel it might be a good idea to send some attorneys down there to help these kids who were getting arrested and abused in Alabama, in North Florida, in Louisiana, and in Mississippi. We better get some lawyers down there. And I was one of those lawyers that volunteered when Father Drinan put this group together called the Lawyers Constitutional Defense Committee. In addition to all this stuff that was going, you had a black arts movement as well. Some of you may remember Eldridge Cleaver. And Eldridge Cleaver, of course, wrote Soul on Ice. And then there was Barack Amira, also was from the New Jersey area, who was doing things like this. And just to put a cap on some of these things that were going on in the 60s, you had a man by the name of Medgar Evers, who was the head of the Mississippi NAACP, who was shot in the back and assassinated when he was going home one evening. And then you had Jack Kennedy, who was shot and assassinated and when he was the President of the United States. And then you had his brother, Robert Kennedy, that was shot and assassinated. And then you had Martin Luther King in this era that was shot and assassinated. And then you had Malcolm X, who said, if anybody puts his hands on me, they're going to end up in the cemetery. Well, he ended up in the cemetery because Malcolm X was shot and killed during that particular period of time. So when you start looking at the various things that had been taking place in the United States, I like to look at it in certain kinds of ways. In maybe there was some hope going on. And some of these movements had a positive spin or an impact on the public. And I think that maybe some of them did, some of them didn't. We have the Southern Poverty Law Center, the Southern Poverty Law Center that is taking place now, and the East Coast, it was kind of an outgrowth of some of the organizations that were existing at that time. What kind of organizations do we have existing at that time? We're energized by all this. We had the ACLU. The ACLU was energized, although they started a lot earlier, and I've been just about a lifetime member of the American Civil Liberties Union myself, involved in many cases. You had an organization called SNCC, the Southern the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. You had SLIC, which was the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Obviously, you had the NACP, which has been around, again, a long time, and we're energized by this. You had CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality, of which I was a member, and at which time, shortly after I joined it, they eliminated all white people in the organization because they felt it contaminated the organization, and maybe it did as far as their message is concerned. You had a movement of the Urban League, which was, again, invigorated by a lot of these issues. So, and then you had other things. Like you had COFO, you had SDS going on, and for you, and when you start looking back in the 60s, you say, my God, I've often thought of maybe putting a course together, you know, of the 60s, but I don't think I would have enough time to start covering the various issues that had taken place during that particular time. A turbulent time in the United States. An extraordinarily turbulent time where people were putting their lives on the line, both adults and young people at the same time. Well, so what happened with me? There was this clergyman that I mentioned, Father Grant, at the University of Boston. And what he decided is, when all these people were going south to do what they were going to be doing, that these people ought to be under some kind of protection, to be given some, you know, good advice, and instead of just dealing with their emotions. And he put together this organization that he called LCDC, the Lawyers Constitutional Defense Committee, and that was the organization. We sent out notices, and because of my activities other than this, I felt that that would be a good organization to be a member of. And he described it as this, as far as freedom to summary. He put out a leaflet, and it went something like this. The job of the lawyer will be to explain to the local officials the constitutional rights of the movement's personnel, to be present at the time of arrest, and thereafter to observe and try to ensure that the persons arrested receive decent treatment, to arrange bond if possible, to appear in court, to preserve constitutional and other federal issues, to take the greatest possible advantage of the applicable federal statutes in order to remove criminal cases to the federal court, to attempt to enjoin unlawful interference with lawful activities, to stimulate the Justice Department as far as possible to intervene to protect constitutional rights, and to initiate federal suits to declare various state statutes unconstitutional. In the closing letter, Father Grinan said, your visit to the South will be all work, frequently in hostile communities, but I believe, as I am sure you do, that the willingness to take part in this program is in the best traditions of the legal profession. Well, he vastly underestimated the kinds of difficulties that we would be facing. In addition to the things that he thought ought to be taken care of, we were very much involved in those days in voter registration and were frustrated at almost at every single turn we took. And I want to describe some of those frustrating issues. Let me pick up some notes here. I'm telling you, when I started looking at this stuff over again, I could feel, you know, did I really go down the right path? How much of this did I really want to resurrect? How much of this did I really want to think about again? And I don't, you know. And you start getting with those, start questioning yourself and that kind of stuff. And, let me see, I have some other things here I wanted to mention at this particular stage. In my emotional things here, I think I've mixed up some of my note pages, but I'll find it. One of the things about the skill level that they were looking for, yes, they were looking for lawyers, and they were looking for people that had these kinds of backgrounds. But in addition to that, they described what they needed to go down south and the kind of people they needed to go down south and what they wanted to do. And he described it something like this. Most any skill a person has can be utilized in this movement. And that includes merely knowing how to read and write. Such things as schools, freedom schools, are being set up to teach many of the people to read and write. And some of the history of our country and voter registration campaigns are being conducted. And charitable artisans, tradesmen, and workers are building and rebuilding churches that have been burned down, schools and recreational and educational facilities, etc. So we were welcome, and particularly with our expertise, and more generally the lawyers were a little bit older than the students going down. At the time I was in my middle 30s, and I had been in, you know, military and all that kind of stuff, and a lot of my compatriots and colleagues that went down at that time to participate in that were roughly my age. So we weren't, I'm not talking the experiences now of a person, a younger person, a person who's 20 or 22 or 18, but these were the folks that were going down and the folks that we were trying to deal with, that we're trying to cure or help some of these injustices. And the things they were doing for them, well, I'll talk about some of those things that those kids, some of those kids faced. Anyway. I signed up. I went down. And this is how it all started out for me. The headquarters for this that was taking place was in New Orleans. It was run by a firm called Collins, Douglas, and Eli. Three black lawyers acted as kind of a clearinghouse for all these things that were taking place in North Florida, in Alabama, in Mississippi, and the north, generally the northeastern part of Louisiana. I didn't know any idea when I went down who would be, who I was to be partnered with, who I was to be assigned with, or what part of the country they were going to be sending me to. And as it worked out that I was being sent up to the northeastern portion of Louisiana, and for those of you that know Louisiana, it was around places that are called like Monroe, Arcadia, Bunkie, occasionally Shreveport, but not very often, and some of the areas up in that particular area. Often we were working down near Lake Pontchartrain, and maybe some of you have heard of the evil man, Leander Perez, and that was supposed to be a kingmaker down in that area. Anyway, so I headed down, when I went down to New Orleans, I ended up at this particular law firm that was screening people. And this law firm was located in the black part of New Orleans. And when we gave, I was by myself, when I gave the address to the cab driver, he said, well, that's the black part of town down there in those days. He said the nigger part of town in those days. And he said, I don't think we ought to go down there. You shouldn't be going down there. I said, that's where I want to go. And I gave the address, and I had a few discussions with the cab driver. And he took me into this black neighborhood and had dropped me off at the address I asked to be dropped off at. Collins, Douglas, and Eli were located on the second floor of a kind of a rundown office building. And they were very happy to see me, and there were other people milling around that were coming in roughly at the same time I was. And they decided to give us a little conference about what we can expect. And what they did is they put together with the group that were just coming out of the northern part of Louisiana. So they were going to give us a talking to, but they wanted to get out of town as fast as they could. So we had this meeting at the airport in New Orleans as just before they were leaving town. But New Orleans at that time, we're talking about the mid-60s in 1964, everything was segregated in New Orleans. When we got to town down there, we went out to eat. This would be a good example. As any, we went out to eat. We walk into a restaurant, and every single table in the restaurant, restaurant was almost empty because we were eating at a fairly odd time. But almost every single table at a restaurant had a reserve sign on it. Every single one, and they were all empty. And we walked in, and we looked around, and he said, what table would you like to sit at? You know, any table you want to. And I said, but they're all reserved. He says, don't worry about that, we'll take care of that. So we picked a table, and he took the reserve sign off the table. Right near, in the black part of town, was a library. The library was a lending library at the time. And it was kind of it was a big building, kind of a stately building, a rundown building. And we walked into this library that all had, the place was filled with empty shelves. And there was about two shelves in this entire large library that was maybe, the two shelves would stand maybe from about here to about here. And those two shelves were the only two shelves in the library that had any books in them, period. And that was segregated as well, a library segregated. The hospitals were segregated in New Orleans. And I could go on, I just listed some of these things, the libraries, the hospitals, the bathrooms, the drinking fountains, the courtrooms were segregated, the places of justice. And the only time I ran into any courtrooms that I felt were handled, in an appropriate way, were some of the federal courtrooms. But those courtrooms, the other courtrooms, state courtrooms, you could count on it, they were segregated places. And there were certain places for black people to sit, and there were certain places for white people to sit. And I was in a courtroom in Monroe, where the judge looked at me, and I was sitting, you know, waiting. I wanted to see what was going on, I wanted to see how justice was meted out. And I was there on a specific case, and as I was sitting back there, the judge points me out back there in the back of the courtroom and says, come forward. He said, you don't sit in the nigger section in our courtroom here. You know, and this was the kind of stuff that I was, had been dealing with and was going to be dealing with more and more and more as my experiences would be extended here. Anyway, the first thing, you know, once again, when I stopped thinking about this, I started thinking about this. I had picked an uncomfortable area that I just didn't want to visit. And but I had started it, and I told them what I would be talking about. I told the school what I'd be talking about. And the more I got into it, I started to feel, maybe even sense it right now when I'm talking about it, the emotional overlay that I had. Feel. About visiting these kind of experiences and gut reactions that I was having, emotional reactions to these issues. Because even though I talk loud and do those things, when I'm working, I tend to be efficient, I tend to be well organized, I expect myself and the kind of background that I have to be able to control my temper and stuff like this. And as I'm reading this stuff again, I'm beginning to feel, you know, you can feel sometimes when it starts to turn red in the neck, and it starts going up. And that's how I was feeling doing this kind of stuff. Again. Anyway, okay. We went to the airport to be briefed by these attorneys that had come out of our new assignments and the kind of issues that they were talking about. And they called this meeting that we were getting together with them. It was myself and one other attorney, they'll tell you my reason. They called it a rules for survival. A rules for survival meeting. To practice law, or to try to practice law in this kind of atmosphere. First thing they said to us, now look, expect to be followed wherever you go. Expect to be followed. Well, we saw exhibits of that right off. About when we start dealing in some of these small towns, when we went in some of these smaller areas. Expect to be followed. I had one policeman sit down with me when I was having a cup of coffee in a small coffee shop. He sat down next to me in one of these small towns, Monroe. Monroe is not that small anymore. I guess Monroe runs about 55,000 people. But he sat down next to me, and this is, he said something like this. He said, you know, when you came to town, he said, you went over such and such a place, and then you went to another place, he named the place I went, and then you wrap over this particular neighborhood, you talk to this person. He's telling me all these things, what he saw I did. He said, but then I lost track of you for about 25 minutes before I was able to pick you up again. He said, where did you go during that 25 minutes? And this is the kind of stuff, you know, there's ways to follow people. And one of the things you learn in police science is sometimes you want people to know you're following them. You want people to be alert to the fact that you got their number. And this guy's telling me every place I went. And he's in addition to that, and I think he was needling me a little bit. I lost track of you for so many minutes. Where were you during that particular time? So, and this became a reality. We would often be picked up by the state police, tailing us. They weren't shy about doing these kinds of things. And then they'd be probably radioed ahead to a small town. We would be met by somebody in the small town, a deputy or somebody of that sort. And he would be not necessarily our escort, but he wanted to see what we were doing. And those kinds of issues of what we were doing. Expect to be followed. He said, and then another survival technique was the rules for reporting our trail. What we were instructed to do when we were down there is to, wherever we slept or wherever we were, would be where we were sleeping. We called in to New Orleans where we were sleeping, where it was, how long we would be there, when we would call back. When we left where we were staying, we called ahead to tell them where we were going, what town we were going to if it was a change of town, and when they could expect to hear back from us. It was something like what the FBI does now. If you're working for the FBI these days, they want to know when you leave home in the morning. They want to know when to be able to contact you, if they want you. So essentially, they had set up rules for us that we would report when we left where we were, how long it would take us to go where we were going, when we would get there, when we would call back. And they gave us a cushion. If we don't hear from you 10 minutes when you're supposed to arrive, we're going to start checking out. We're going to start calling different people. We're going to start having people check out. Rules for survival. Another rule for survival they gave us was, always you rent a car, you rent a private car, get it from a local agency. So the car doesn't look like it's coming from out of town. Get a car that's recognizable that comes from a local agency. They told us what to expect of the police. And it was not funny. They told us what to expect of the FBI. Let me tell you an experience I had with the FBI down there. In Monroe, they had a small FBI office up there. And we went in, which was right across from a Louisiana congressional representative, Otto Passman at the time. But anyway, we went across to the FBI and to talk to them and tell them who we were and what we were doing and all these other things. And they said, well, we have nothing to do with it. We're a neutral agency. Now, I always thought the FBI was a law enforcement agency, among other things. But they informed us that they're a neutral agency. They don't take sides. So we shouldn't expect them to go on one side or another. And in Shreveport, when we visited the FBI, they told us when we started trying to file some cases and draft some lawsuits about what people should be doing and how their constitutional rights were treated, they told us, we never had cases like this before. We never had cases. And besides, we're supposed to protect our neutrality. The FBI was telling us that they're supposed to be neutral. When they see crimes taking place, when they see law enforcement that taking place, and I'll tell you just in very short order here, I'll tell you about one of our experiences with the head of the Justice Department in Washington, D.C. concerning these very, very issues. At the time, we also saw some affidavits when we were being turned into investigators and supposed to function like lawyers. Let me read you a very short portion of one of these affidavits. Sheriff Holly took me back to the car of the highway patrolman. He opened the car and the highway patrolman told me to get inside. I got inside and sat on the back seat. He told me to move over and got in. All the doors and windows were shut. He said, I can't kill you, but you know what I'm going to do to you? I answered, no, sir. At this time, he pulled his gun out of his holsters and started to hit me on the head with the gun butt. I put my hands up to protect my head and rolled into a ball on the seat. Over a period of about a minute, he hit me about 4 times on the head and about 8 to 10 times on the left hand. He also hit me 3 times on the left leg, 2 times on my right hand, and 1 time on my left shoulder. All of this was with the gun butt. 3 of them then went up to Eric. They had a conversation with Eric, which I could not hear, and one of the men raised a gun and struck Eric, knocking him down. He got up and was knocked down again. I had been sitting in the car through all of this. I felt the blood on my face and on my arm. The man who had beaten me then came back to the car and sat down in the back seat. He picked up a flashlight and hit me across the mouth. I then rolled into a ball again, and he put the gun to my temple and cocked it, and he said, "If you move, I'm going to blow your brains out." Okay. Then, some of the other stuff that I've seen affidavits of. One was gasoline in North Florida. Was Paul Pearl, excuse me, was Paul all over the world. In our area, some of the kids that were picked up noticed that on the floor of a squad car was about 7 or 8 hand grenades. One of the techniques they used in picking up some of these freedom workers were something that would go like this. They would pick them up for running through a red light that wasn't red, or speeding when they weren't speeding, or they would pick them up on various pretexts. And then when they picked them up, they'd take them down to the station. And then when they would put them in a cell, crowded cell, with some of the local ne'er-do-wells and workers, and they would say, "Here's some of those carpetbaggers from up north coming down." And then they would leave them in the cell with these guys and turn around and walk away. I don't have to tell you what took place in that cell after the policemen left these students and young people in cells. These were the kind of things that we were asked to write complaints about. You're expected to put pleadings about, and I'm expected to file these pleadings. We had some trouble doing that. And while I was down there, Jonesburg, which is really near, very close to Monroe, was a very small town. They had a Klan and a White Citizens Council parade. Who led the parade? A local squad car in Jonesboro, Louisiana. The kind of stuff that we saw over and over again. And the survival techniques that we were advised to take care of and to, you know, live with. These were the kinds of problems that Father Ryan was telling us to deal with. Some more stuff about these kinds of areas. One of our assignments was checking out a young kid who drank out of a white water fountain in Arcadia, Louisiana. Again, Arcadia is right about the middle of the northern part of Louisiana. Drinking out of a white water fountain, they found him guilty of disturbing the peace because he did that. And he was given 6 months on a work gang up in near Homer, Louisiana. And he was working outdoors on a, and he asked us to check on it and to see if we can do anything to help this black kid who drank out of a white water fountain. So we went to see the sheriff of the area. And when we went in to see the sheriff and told some of his reception people what we wanted to talk to the sheriff about, they very politely said, "We'll just have to wait a minute, wait 1 minute, and we'll set you up so you can see the sheriff." And we sat down and we waited. When I say we waited, I'm talking about a fellow they paired me with by the name of Jack Burnett, who was a probate lawyer, I might add, from California, who's in the wine business as well. A probate lawyer, as you know, is somebody who makes out wills for estates and things of that sort. They paired me up with Jack, and they also sent along with us one of the black lawyers from Lois, Douglas and Eli, and that was Lois. And so we're sitting there waiting and waiting. Waiting. And after a very long time, then they ushered us in to see the sheriff. And all three of us, now we got 3 lawyers, all 3 of us, Jack and myself were told to sit in front with the 2 chairs facing the desk of the sheriff. And Lois was told to sit in back of us because he doesn't want any niggers near the desk. And, okay, so Lois, of course, after what he went through to get a law degree, he was treated like that, you know, it was outrageous. But anyway, so we aligned ourselves like that. And on this sheriff's desk was lined up like soldiers, cattle prods. He must have had 8 or 9 cattle prods all set up on his desk. And he looked at us and he says, okay, what can I do for you? And to describe this guy was a very, very short, fat, ugly person. I don't normally deal with people's looks, because sometimes, you know, they can fool you. Sometimes you can have the nicest people disfigured in certain kinds of ways. But this guy looked like a, when I think back on it, I want to say something like, he looked something like a bloated turd. I'll try to restrain myself. I'm not very good at that, as some of my students know. But anyway, he talked to us about these issues that we wanted to find out about this young kid that was, you know, in another spot, and in Homer. And he said, well, you can look at the court records. That's fine. The records didn't tell you anything other than the fact he got 6 months. And then he says, I can call the DA ahead up in Homer, and if you want to see him up there. And I was informed by Lois, would be crazy to go up there. Absolutely insane. And since he knew the territory, or I thought he knew the territory better than we did, we figured that, you know, it would be insane to go up there. And he assured us also that there was, in a lot of these small towns in northern Louisiana, there wasn't any media coverage or anybody, you know, even that, where we could make a story, you know, where people would keep being an eye on us. So he took his advice and didn't go up there. So, another situation. We were asked to assist a group of core workers, 3 core workers, who were working in Monroe, Louisiana, which is kind of north central, maybe a little to the east of north central. A city of that time, Monroe was a city of that time, would be very close to about 50,000 people. So it was a little bigger than what we were used to seeing. And we had heard that they had arrested 15 core workers up there who were trying to pass petitions around and trying to help people to vote and so forth and so on. So we went up to Monroe. And in Monroe, they had, again, the black part of town, and the kids that were, you know, working at this, the 3 or 4 kids that were working at this place, were at the second floor in the slum area. It was run by a civil rights core worker by the name of Mike Lesser. And we were struck by the fact that when we went to see this group, first of all, this particular office, if you want to call it that, it was ramshackle. Worn down, I guess a couple of bare pieces of furniture, maybe 2 or 3 straight back wooden chairs were very old. And Mike Lesser and the kids that worked there looked like they just gotten out of a German prison camp. When I say that, I mean, you know, their faces were drawn, they were white, they looked hungry, they looked, you know, because they were, the amounts of money that they were living off of was very, very spare, and, you know, were primarily by donations and people who were trying to be in sympathy with them, and they're generally parts of the black community. And yet, and one of the things we noticed up in this office, their phone would ring. And then they would pick it up, hold it to their ear, and then put it down. The phone would ring again. They would pick it up, you know, and I'd say, well, what's going on? Just call me. And they say, well, we get about 200 over 200, and they, you know, every time the phone would ring, they'd put a, you know, slash down, then 5 and 4 and then a point across. Over 200 calls a day, they're telling me they're harassing calls. Why don't you change your phone number? It doesn't do any good to change the phone number, because if you change the phone number, then they start calling on the other number. So they were getting one after another, these kind of harassing calls, in addition to the kinds of things that they were trying to do with helping these people, giving them advice on how to vote. Now, how do you prevent people from voting? Well, there's all kinds of little things that you can do to prevent people from voting. Well, for example, at the time I was there, what they were doing in order to prevent people from voting. They had to show who they were when they showed up at the booths and showed up at the voting stations. Who are you? Well, in order to prove who you are, you have to have two items to, you know, of identification. One might be an item showing that you have insurance. Another item might be that you had a driver's license. And they would have it all spelled out that the kinds of things that the average black guy on the street didn't have. In other words, how many people in those days, way back then, you know, used to carry around evidence of their insurance, life insurance, stuff like that, you know, and how many people actually drove a car or were able to afford a car in order to drive a car in those days? Darn few. So as a result, and as far as the reading ability, that is, again, a whole different ballgame going on. You know, I'm going to show you something. Well, you can't read? Okay, I'll read it for you. But I'll tell you what we need. And of course, it was always, whenever the issue came up, it was always decided about the person who was trying to assert what rights they are. So in a situation like this, what were you faced with? And I can give you all these little anecdotal issues in dealing with the kinds of people. Well, first of all, if we didn't put any pleadings together, in which we did put different kinds of pleadings together to challenge this person or that person, but where do you get a typewriter to use? Who will lend you a typewriter? There was a couple of occasions I can think of, with one was a black attorney who was in the northern part of Louisiana that would let us use a typewriter. Then we needed paper. Then you remember carbon paper? We don't use carbon paper anymore. But then we had to have certain number of multiple copies. So we were running all over the place for things like ink, pencils, paper, carbon paper. Occasionally we needed to make copies, so we had to use, remember, bibliograph, that issue. And this is the kind of stuff we had to go out here. And then after we would prepare the stuff, who would file it for us in the federal court? They wouldn't let us file it for us because we were attorneys that were out-of-town attorneys, and we didn't have we weren't regulated in a proper way. Now, if I had a case, for example, right now in Indiana or in Michigan or someplace like that, I'm licensed in Illinois and a couple of other places. But let's say that I had to have a case in a place that I wasn't registered today or a long time ago when I was living up, I was living up north. That's, you know how I feel right now. But, you know, there's a certain reciprocity that takes place. Now, if I wanted to file something in Iowa, and I'm not an attorney in Iowa, that wouldn't have any trouble filing something in Iowa. You know, if you have a certain reciprocity, or if I really couldn't do it, I can walk right across the street from the courthouse and ask somebody to file it for me. No problem at all. But generally, they would take any papers I have right now. What do you take? Down there, nobody would touch any of the things that we wanted to file, and we couldn't file these various documents that we had, except I remember one attorney who was polite enough to do that kind of thing for us, whereas a motion was immediately filed and our odd pleadings were dismissed, and they were unique. They were just traditional things. But, you know, this concept of running all over the place in order to do very mundane tasks, you know, typing something up. Secretarial services were out of the question. Nobody couldn't get any secretarial services to help us at all, even if we needed it. It was all us up to type, to do it, to come up with the money, to do certain kinds of things. Every step we took in a different direction, there was a certain obstacle that were automatically put in our place. I visited one court, the one who she was taking one court in Monroe. I was in court, I got out of court, came out, the side of my car was smashed. Somebody had obviously backed something into the side of our rental car. So we had to turn that in, get another car, in order to have wheels. I was in a place called Bunky, Louisiana, which is almost dead center in the state. We stopped at Bunky, and we had a cup of coffee and donut and stuff like that, and then we went into a hardware store. And we figured that the more we looked like their definition of crackers, the better off we might be. So we go into the hardware store and we get, you know, two of these straw hats, one for Jack and one for myself. And the clerk in the hardware store said to us, where are you from? We went, we said, well, we're looking for a place to fish around here. He said, you know, your hands don't look like you're used to manual labor. Well, when you ever hear my name, you walk into a store to buy something. Where the proprietor of the store, he said, you know, your hands don't look like, you know, like they're used to manual labor. Indeed, they weren't. We were paper shoppers. And this is the kind of stuff we were hearing every little place that we had stopped, and every place we were going. And then, of course, I'm telling you, you know, you don't travel with black people in your car unless you have to. Don't do that kind of stuff. We were followed in and out of towns on a regular basis. It was like they had, you know, this whole thing that went going ahead for state troopers, local policemen, you know. And I'll tell you something, you know, as I'm standing up here, not only am I becoming emotionally involved in this stuff, I'm starting to feel myself getting angry. I said when we were in Monroe, we were right at the FBI office, was right across the office from Otto Passman, who was the congressional representative for that area at the time. He asked us what we were there for. And we were out in the hall talking. We told him who we were and what we're there to see the FBI about. We wanted to talk to the FBI. I won't tell you what we called the FBI at that time. But the last two words were a bunch of idiots. Anyway, Otto Passman takes us into office. And he starts showing us all of his tokens of grandeur. Of who's you get pictures taken of, he was extraordinarily flavorless. And I say, you know, it was like eating chocolate cake with chocolate sauce, with more chocolate sauce. You know, he was showing us, he had a picture here with this particular politician. He had a picture here with this actress. And he had a picture here with so-and-so. And he took us around, and he showed us little knickknacks from Washington. And, you know, we left Otto and his passman there, you know, because we weren't accomplishing anything dealing with him, other to listen to him brag about, you know, his accomplishments of who he knew and how he knew him. And it wasn't Huey Newton and the news or whatever. Okay. Some of the others that made an impression. When trying to get plaintiffs for some of these petitions, you know, you have to have people. If you're going to say people, you have to have people that to represent. So the kinds of people we had a lot of cooperation from the black community, but very, very little cooperation from black men. Almost all the people who were willing to cooperate with us were black women because they didn't feel as threatened as the black men did, because, you know, a black man was liable to be taken out and shot. And I might have mentioned, and I think some of the literature passed out indicated, we got down there the day after Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney were pulled out of the Mississippi swamps. The day after. And, you know, and the black men didn't want to put themselves in that kind of a position. They felt they were more liable to get punished or more liable to get fired from jobs than black women, who were often domestics and other people were relying on them. So most of the plaintiffs that we were able to get down there and to put on these petitions that didn't feel as threatened were black women, but not black men. Some of the other issues we were dealing with. We talked about our policeman Potts that was letting us know what we were doing. Okay. You mentioned there was a vote here and some other issues. Well, after going through the FBI and getting no results with the FBI, Jack Burnett, my partner at the time, and by the way, I want you all to know that what I used to kid him about constantly, these bags that we carried very few clothes when we were running around doing these things, he always carried a bottle of scotch. It was absolutely necessary that he drink a lot of scotch before he went to bed that night. And I also mentioned the fact about some of our sleeping accommodations. You know, you start calling up churches and telling them maybe you can sleep on the pews and places like that in churches, or have, you know, some people of note turn you down, or clergymen of light variety of faiths turn you down. So sleeping in various places they have. What you end up doing is, because the only people who were cooperating with you in any way were, of course, some of these black families. So they would try to put you up in some of these ramshackle places that some of you have seen in the South. And we would often end up sleeping in the place of the middle of black neighborhoods, or in black ramshackle shacks. And essentially, the people that we were giving us these places to sleep on the floor, generally the floor was the best place, because if you slept on the mattress, I don't think you'd ever get rid of the body waste in some of these places. But anyway, but essentially, you'd be sleeping kind of in the middle of these groups in the black neighborhoods, and they would were able to provide an alarm and some safety for you and to sleep in, because if the other people, the particular clergymen, which we, you know, call up and tell them who we were and ask if we had a place where we could stay, or could we stay in the church, or could we stay in the synagogue, or can we stay in whatever. And the university, they say, gee, we can't do that. Or I'll have to check with our board of directors and I'd come back. No, we're awfully sorry, we apologize, but we can't have you sleeping over here. Because, of course, one of the things that they were doing in those days, they were burning down churches as well. You know, there were all kinds of stuff going on in Peoria, by the way, with this particular issue. But how am I doing here? Okay. Let me wind this up. And some of the people here asked me if I would take some questions. If they have any, I'd be glad to do that. But I visited in 1995. They had a reunion in Jackson, Mississippi, of the people that had gone down. Roughly close to 150 lawyers went down there. And at this meeting in Jackson, Mississippi, this kind of reunion meeting that took place roughly 30 years or more, about 30 years after we had gone down, we had turnout of about, as I recall, specifically about 44 lawyers, and then we had a bunch of other people at this reunion. We had a lot of reporters there and other people who wanted to hear what he had to say. And he had written some nice stories for the Jackson newspaper. And there were other people just there that were involved in the civil rights movement and other places. And one of the questions that we start talking about, in addition to telling, you know, war stories and what happened here and what happened there, going through all this anecdotal stuff that I was making notes of before I came here today, is the question is, do we do any good? But, you know, what was happening? Did we really do any good? Did we make any impact on the thing? Or was just this is a useless exercise of, you know, of fear sweat and a bunch of other issues where, you know, nothing was really done? And the kinds of things that we were talking about is the kind of stuff that we felt that we made some impact, not a lot, some impact, is we kept some of the local movements that we had dealt with going on. We kept some of these local movements, you know, we gave them a little sermon or pep talk and helped them a little bit. That we held in some cases some public officials accountable for the kinds of things they were doing. If nothing else, because it would be inconvenient to deal with. So if they were going to do something, you might have to be a little more careful or do it a little slower, but, you know, they'd end up doing it anyway. But some of the issues that they dealt with, as far as we were concerned, is we caused some of the local officials to slow down in some of the places we dealt with because we made a little inconvenience. Some of the legal stuff we were able to file, or at least put in filing form, that they were maybe able to use, other attorneys were able to use at a later time, may have helped a little. Very little. Some of the harassment that some of these people were getting sometimes did not go unanswered. In other words, we caused some people to do things that were inconvenient for them to do. Some other things was where we were able to take back some of these experiences to where we lived up in the north, like I, and talk to the people up there about some of the things that were going on down south. And those are the things that we felt, you know, that we're doing major work. It wasn't a lot. It was very little. And then we were asked to respond to certain questions that the press was asking us at that time when we were up in Jackson. And a couple of the fellows were asked certain questions. And one of them answered this. What are you going to tell your children when they ask where you were? And he said this. If I hadn't done it, could somebody else have done it? Sure. Anybody with my training and limited experience could have done it. But I was a piece of that whole thing, and it was a case of my putting where my money was, where my mouth was. And there's a very few times in your life where you're really going to get to do that. One of the responses. Another one response, a very big response, was something like this. It was probably the one thing in my whole legal career which made being a lawyer worthwhile. I really saw the effect of what I did. The rest of it is all bullshit. It is all shoveling papers or money or other things around. But for me, it was the most gratifying, unequivocally, the most gratifying experience of my professional life. The last night of this reunion that we had in Jackson, we had dinner at Kugelu College, some of you may be familiar with. It's a small black college, which is right near Jackson. And we had a southern dinner. They had a nice southern dinner for us. Chicken, greens, mashed potatoes. We've had a lot of speeches by some of the local folks and some of the faculty at Kugelu and some of the people that hadn't been there. But one of the interesting things, we had a very nice speech from one of the leading jurists of the state of Mississippi, Justice Banks. Up until that time, there were there were only a handful, maybe a half a dozen black lawyers in the whole state of Mississippi. At the time of this reunion in 1995, there was about 400 black lawyers there. And the head of the Mississippi Bar Association was Justice Banks, and he was a judge. Didn't have anything like that when I was down there at all. And anyway, one of the local guys got up, one of the black guys at the college got up. He asked us all to stand up and the students to stand up, talking about new friends and old friends. And he asked us to all join hands. He joined hands, he started singing. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. Someday, deep in my heart, I do believe